right there. You're cool. Hey everybody, how are you? Good evening, good morning. That's it. Good afternoon. Look at that.
Nice.
Right off the bat.
I'm a trained professional.
Can't beat that. That's true, you are. You're a very trained professional. Hey everybody, how are you? Jeff Gellman of Solid Canine Training. Monday night, back to our regular time, at least this week. All right, so redo it.
Oh, here we go.
Those are joins. That actually
I've
is
never
right.
seen those.
Yeah, I know.
I've never seen them.
So maybe they upgraded the software. Hey, how's everybody doing tonight? It's Q&A. You can ask your dog training questions. Answers are short. Answers are sweet. Sometimes they're not so sweet. I do this from 8 till 9 p.m. Eastern Standard Time on Mondays.
Hey,
Dope Man, what's up? How are you? That was a short marriage, huh? I got married, got divorced. All right, Shay is already on Tinder. I saw her there yesterday. I hope everybody's doing okay. If you're brand new to my show, let me introduce myself. My name is Jeff Gellman. I am with Solid Canine Training, and I'm based in Providence, Rhode Island. I've got a board and train facility there. We specialize in aggression rehab and behavior modification. So we deal with some pretty intense dogs and intense behaviors, and we rehabilitate them and train them. But also we do young puppies, and we do basic on and off leash obedience. I personally travel the world doing, you know, dog training seminars. So you can go to rvdogtrainer.com or solidcaninetraining.com. And if you're brand new, what you're going to do is you're going to see a lot of folks that are going to be asking how to stop bad behavior, how to stop bad behavior. So a lot of my answers are going to be punishment based, because the only way you can actually stop a bad behavior is through punishment. And the only way you can get a dog to do something is through a reward. Pretty simple. So we do both. Next.
Hi from California. Counter surfing wolfhound. Best way to get her to stop? Love you guys.
The best, simplest way to get a dog to stop, and which is I like to do that, I like to go right for what actually works. Remote collar on the dog. You want to have the remote collar. We like collars from e-collar technology. But as far as counter surfing, since you're using it for a high level of punishment, a lot of the collars probably would work just for this protocol. Remote collar on the dog, put it on the highest setting, make sure it's fit right, have the food up on the counter, and watch from either a camera system or through a window. And as soon as that dog is on the counter eating the food, I want you to hold that button down on the remote collar for 3 seconds. Nobody should enjoy doing it. Does it hurt the dog? Absolutely. You know, it absolutely hurts the dog, as it should. I'm sorry, but there are many things in dog training that the dog should be very uncomfortable if it does. The dog, normally the punishment is it's a split second. For this punishment, though, you want it to be 3 seconds long, and you want it to be very, very uncomfortable. Why? A dog could die. Dogs die by getting on counters and eating things. Also, what happens is if the dog doesn't die, and say it gets a roast or a high value food source, and you go to get it from that dog, often owners are also bit. So there's a lot of different variables on that. So I'm trying to keep dogs alive. And also, resource guarding dogs are killed in shelters automatically. Next.
Have you heard about pure positive people in Colorado trying to create legislation?
Yeah, Patrick, I haven't heard that one, but I'm sure the IACP is going to be on it. If you're not a member of the International Association of Canine Professionals, whether you're a groomer, a dog trainer, a dog owner, I encourage everybody to go to canineprofessionals.com, pay your $65 to $100 and join, because they're huge advocates of everybody that trains dogs, no matter how you train them. Unfortunately, what's happening is the pure positive people are using the abuse card, and they're quoting science, but it actually isn't science. So it happened in Toronto. It happened down in Hillsborough. Everybody needs to write in to legislation to make sure that they don't let this follow through. And this has got nothing to do with prong collars and remote collars. The typical legislation that they are trying to pass is you can't say no to your dog. That's the legislation. Not a remote collar, not a prong collar. You're not allowed to say no to your dog. That's the typical legislation. So how would you like to be legislated that says if you say no to your dog, you're breaking the law?
Next. I just got a dog and I started training it. Why won't she play with me now, and what can I do about it?
Well, that can happen a lot. the dog, maybe what you're doing is you're just doing a really good job, you know, training the dog, or maybe you're doing a bad job training the dog. I don't know. I don't know how you're training the dog. I don't know the dog. I don't know your training techniques. I don't have any video. Please don't send me any because I'd have to charge for that. But what can happen is this. It's possible that your dog is just now just concerned. Maybe just concerned about you for a little bit. That doesn't mean afraid of you, just might be concerned. So what I would do is this, I would just go through the motions and give your dog direction. What you wanna do is you wanna have an on and an off switch, or what you were interpreting as play was actually bad behavior. So a lot of dogs, what happens is when you stop all that bad behavior, they get calm, but it all evens out. So what I would do is I would find out some way, does your dog have toy drive? Does it have football drive, which is a toy? Is there food drive? Try to engage that dog into some more high activity things, some confidence building things like some agility equipment, and it should even out for you. Next.
Thank you and your staff for what you did for Kevin. I love watching his progress.
Oh, thank you, Tony. It was actually all, I mean, I'm the one that spearheaded it, but that's all my staff that did all the training. I'm just a big mouth. Thank you. But yeah, it's pretty incredible. And kudos to the new owner that actually is actually, you know, getting him. So next.
Hey guys, what kind of pool do you have at your facility?
Michael, that is actually a, we got it on Amazon. It's a 12 by 24 above ground pool. It was a little bit under $1,000. We got the upgraded pump on that. We would have liked to get the bigger one, but the space, the width, we couldn't fit into our little alley right there. If you know, it's pretty, pretty tight right there. So, and then we built the deck above it. It's 52 inches high. It's a great, great pool for dogs. Next.
Jeff, my 15-month bulldog gets ridiculous around other people and dogs on walks. How do I correct?
Tony, I'm not quite sure what you mean by ridiculous. What I would do is this, though. If your dog is out of control, teach your dog how to walk calmly. So I'm a big advocate of tools. Tools enable you to empower owners to help communicate the training. So get a prong collar for your dog and teach your dog how to properly heel next to you. And then teach your dog your on-off switch. So teach it how to do a down, teach it how to do a place. When the dog gets super excited and if it's jumping on people, you're going to punish that. It's not cute at all. It's actually quite annoying. That doesn't mean the dog's happy to see people at all. So it's all that arousal that you want to eliminate. So I love active dogs. These dogs right there are highly active dogs, but right now they're in my office and we're doing a little bit of a Periscope Q&A. So they need to be lying down there. So make sure your dog understands when you're outside playing off leash, like with ball, frisbee, swimming, hiking, walking in a field, you can be in drive, you can be running around. But when you're in the house and there's people over, I want you to be calm. Next.
Trying to train my dad's dog. They only have a choke collar. Any suggestions?
So Dan, this is the thing is, prong collars are what, $20, $25? I'm sure they've got the money for that. But it's really hard to train a dog on a choke chain. It's very difficult to train a dog on a choke chain. Their timing has to be pretty impeccable. And I think it's really, really hard for your average dog owner, let alone dog trainer, to master a choke chain. So I would say get a prong collar. But either way, you can do food-based training. Just do food-based training to start. Just get the dog shaping and all the commands. You can use the choke to correct, but a prong is just so much easier to correct. Next.
Tony says he starts to pull and lunges on the prong collar.
So what happens is when the dog is starting to pull, that's when you have to give the information. So you've got to right about when the dog is, so once the dog is pulling and lunging, you lost it. You missed your opportunity. So if you're trying to stay sober and you already have the drink at the bar, you lose. You're gone. So what you need to do is, what you can do is you could get as soon as that dog starts thinking about lunging, give that dog information. All right, next.
On Skype, you talked about a high correction before a walk. Is this paired with no reactive dog?
Yes, it is, David. Next.
Been watching videos for a long time, whining and crate. E-collar correction was high and didn't work.
So you want to do something called fishing?
Oh, and continue to whine after.
So you want to do something called fishing? First of all, make sure the dog doesn't have to go to the bathroom, number one. If the dog doesn't have to go to the bathroom, now it's behavioral. So what you can do is you can fish. You can go down low. You can do continuous. You can do momentary. You go up high. You can walk up to the dog. You can say no, and you can bonk the front of the crate, hit the food bowl on top of the crate. You can shake the crate, open up the crate door, slam the door back in the face. You know, all these things some people might struggle with. And like, oh no, make the dog more comfortable in the crate. You don't need to make a dog comfortable in a crate for it to lie down. And then some people will say, oh, if you do all those things, the dog will hate the crates. Bullshit. The dog already hates the crates. Like, these are all these like theories that people think about are going to happen, but they're not. It's called imaginary harm. So you're not saying that. So what I would do is just do those things that I recommended. Next.
Hey, Jeff from Hap in
Dallas. Oh, hey, Hap, what's going on?
You always expect recall immediately while dog is working 100%. Sometimes she's still mustering / driving.
You know, this is the thing, Eric. You know, I want as close to 100% as I can get. You know, are there things that are 100%? It would be awesome. But what you're going to do is if the dog is knowingly blowing you off, knowingly, correct. Next.
Should I use Bonker while walking when he gets reactive, or just pre-walk to get his mind settled?
Both. Next.
I let my Bernese Mountain Dog in a friend's house, took leash off, and she jumped over sofa.
Yep. Sounds about right, Karen. Why? So number one, why did you let your untrained dog off leash in a friend's house? So that's human error on that part. So disrespectful as well. Doesn't make you a bad person. That's why you're here, because you probably want to know what to do. So what I would do is keep your, if your dog does not know how to behave in other people's houses, it needs to be kept on a leash. Very simple concept. Keep it on a leash. Teach it how to lie down. Go to your friend's house. Have it lie down. Go to place. That's what I would do. So I would never let my dog off leash in someone's house unless it listened to me to a verbal command. Next.
Oh, Andika, thank you. My daughter and I are going to go Thursday and get our hair done together.
Oh, nice.
Yes.
Yeah. Nice.
How did you get interested in dog training?
Max, my dog I had, he's been dead for 2 years. So about 13 years ago, I had a really, really badly behaved dog that nobody can help. And I went to a bunch of trainers that told me to kill him, and they couldn't do anything, and they made it worse, and he was biting humans, biting dogs. I did everything wrong personally. So what I would do is I would finally found somebody who can help me, and that's how my journey started. Next.
Can you train a dog without a prong, because I want them to be therapy dogs?
So yes, you could, Lisa. I understand about therapy dogs, but you can also train them with a prong, and then when they do therapy work, they don't use the prong. You can train a dog with a remote collar, and then when it's time for them to do therapy work, they don't have a remote collar on. If you want, you can put a martingale collar on them as well. So you can do all your training with the tools, and then when it's time to go to work, they can have the tools off. And if the therapy school that you're going to doesn't allow you to use tools, I would then find another school. All right, next.
Dogs have a ton of structure during play. At what point do you think it's too rough? It's fun to watch.
When there's blood. I mean, today I was doing a Periscope, and if you saw the Periscope, I was talking about dogs living outside, and a couple of my dogs were just getting loud, which you know, was annoying at the moment because I was trying to talk, so I told them to knock it off. You know, I told them to knock it off. But, you know, the bottom line is if you know your dogs don't, if it doesn't turn into a fight, they can do it. I don't let my dogs play with other dogs like that, but I do let my pack play pretty rough. Next.
Tips for introducing an adult dog to a new 8-week puppy.
Well, you definitely don't want to F it up, that's for sure. So what you want to do is what I want you to do is this. I want you to work on existence. So your 8-week-old puppy is going to be going through a couple of different fear stages. You definitely don't want it to be a bad experience. So I would go with existence, and I would make sure your older dog is nice and calm, doesn't overpower the puppy. I don't want that puppy to be, you know, afraid of the older dog. But if it is, don't baby the dog. Just move the other dog away. All right, next.
I'm trying to figure out when my dog is just looking interested in something versus loading anxiety.
So
if I correct and she goes right back to anxious staring, correct strongly.
Yeah, if that's what the dog is doing, if the dog is loading and steering with bad intent, I mean, intent is really, really important. It's important that we all understand how to read intent in our dogs. Ladies, you know what intent is. Ever since you were a young girl, and you've had people staring at you, usually people of the opposite sex, I think you're really good on figuring out what someone's intent is. So for us dudes, I think we can flip that as well, and not to say women have not looked at us lovingly and lustfully. Unfortunately, it hasn't happened to me. in a while, but I can remember back in the day when I was a youngin that women would look at me lustfully. But I think what would happen is if the dog is looking with intent, like I want to hurt you, I want to rush you, I want to jump at you. I think what's going to happen is this. Thank you so much. I was not fishing for compliments.
I was going to say, you're totally fishing for
compliments. No, I was not. Not at all. I was trying to make a point. Right. And be funny as well at the same time. I think it's that means that your dog is just not paying attention to you. Next.
Awesome. Thanks for clarification, because it's sometimes a blow off. Rarely, though. Thanks so much.
Yeah. Next.
Possible to look at object and stare while relaxed?
It's intense, yeah.
Dog hides under bed after e-collar correction.
So, Peggy, that means the leash is not attached to the dog. So the leash is not attached to the dog. So I think it's important that whenever you have to teach a dog what a correction is, what is a punishment. So punishment should always be fair as well. So if you're punishing your dog, I think it should be on a leash so it doesn't rush underneath the bed. To me, punishment should be momentary, and then we move on to the next thing that we're working on, or we keep working on what we are working on. So what I would do is I would keep a leash on your dog if you find that you have to punish your dog if it does run away. If you punish your dog and it stays there, that's another thing. Next.
Dog gets excited and loses mind when corrected, yelps loud, even though it was a low correction.
Okay.
It's surprising him, but I get weird looks when he yelps, even though I know it was light.
So you've got a vocal dog. First of all, don't worry about what society thinks. F society. Okay? Anybody can train their dog any way they want to. I won't judge you. You don't judge me. But if your dog runs over and bites me, that's a problem. If your dog jumps on me, that's a problem. If your off-leash dog rushes my dogs, that's a problem. So you can train your dog any way you want to. Just don't let it affect my life. So if your dog yelps, it yelps. There you go. Next.
I think it's surprising him. Oh, wait.
Yep, we already did that. Yep.
Sorry.
If you're just tuning in, my name is Jeff Gellman of Solid Canine Training. If you want to learn more about me, you can start following me. People can also share this if they want to. And you can go to my website, solidcaninetraining.com. We do so much on Instagram, so much on Pinterest, so much on Periscope, Facebook, Facebook Live, our website, YouTube. Next.
Run Gata, we already answered a question about counter surfing. Our first question of the night, actually.
Go back to the first question of the night. It takes 3 seconds to stop counter surfing. Next.
Thanks, Jeff. Dog is staying in place when people come into house.
Awesome. Excuse me, awesome dog, proud of you.
Will you describe the difference in bribing with food versus rewarding?
Yeah, Bo, probably many, I'm sure you asked 3 dog trainers and they'll give you 3 different answers on that. To me, whenever you're doing food training, if you're doing food training with alluring, you're luring the dog into position, you would have the food in your hand. But if you're doing, say, formal clicker training, in my opinion, the food should not be in sight. So the food should not be in sight. The dog should always wonder, are they going to be rewarded or not be rewarded? So different people have different opinions on that. Next.
Okay.
David, I'm trying to get to Australia. David, you know anybody in Brisbane? I'd love to do a seminar in Brisbane.
At what point in training can I start socializing in public spaces, gets kind of reactive, whines, ears up?
Well, Kiki, socializing is different than existing. So I don't want your dog to be meeting other dogs in public. That I don't want at all. I want your dog to learn how to ignore dogs in public. I think that's a really important point, because what's going to happen is your dog is going to, say your dog is super friendly and it wants to meet all these dogs. I don't want that. I don't want you to be sitting in a cafe and a dog walks by and your dog goes, I want to say hello to that dog. I want your dog to learn how to ignore dogs in public. I actually want your dog to learn how to ignore people in public. I want you to be everything to your dog, so therefore you can take your dog places. But as far as getting your dog socialized, yes, I want you to, you know, I want you to do that. So what I want you to do with that is in socialization groups, you can get your dog to be socialized with other dogs. You can have it socialized with other people in pre-planned training things. So you'd have your dog maybe sitting down, invite people over, invite people over to your dog, ask them to pet them. But I don't want random. I never let people come up to my dogs and pet them. And I never let dogs come up to my dogs and say hello, and vice versa. Next.
Why would GSD growl and bite if I walk past him at night and he gets woken up?
Lisa, that's a good question. But the dog should be in a crate at night. So dog should be in a crate at night. Could be just a start. It could be a startle reflex. But that could be punished as well. Next.
Dogs are great on prong, but I struggle with e-collar. It's tight, but not getting a good reaction.
So Donna, you have to teach the dog. Remember, the remote collar is not a magic button. You still have to train the dog through guidance and training. So what's happening is what's happening is to make sure the dog is feeling it, and then watch all my how-to videos on how to do it. Next. Would I host a bite or sports trainer? Michael Fraz is doing a seminar in July, I believe. So I am hosting a sport dog trainer at my training center in Providence, Rhode Island. If you go to rvdogtrainer.com, go underneath the Jeff Gellman Presents caption, and you can see him. And it's very low. It's not very expensive because he's a new presenter. Next.
Hold on, guys. What's happening here? I constantly have to... Wait.
Just do anything, honey.
Should I teach a verbal cue to just look at me with good focus? Never heard it done.
Yeah, people do that all the time. People do look at me. Or they say the dog's name. Personal choice. Next.
How do you name reinforce commands dog is already by instinct performing? Feel missing opportunities.
You can click or train the dog, and when it does something, click and reward it and then name it. Next.
I constantly have to correct my dog for trying to walk ahead. Timing issue or attention on prong?
Caroline, go to my 180 video in my YouTube channel. In my YouTube channel search box, type in 180. It's a video of me and Arati. Try that.
Hoping you announce the California location in November soon.
I have to find it first. I can't announce it until I find it. So I have no idea what I'm doing in California in November yet, but boy, we better book that soon because we want to start selling tickets. Without a location, I can't have a seminar. So I'm open to the whole coast. San Francisco down. Next.
What bad behavior can't be fixed with pure positive? Is that what it is?
Yeah, no bad behavior can be fixed.
A ton of BS is on Facebook in my area. I want to call out their
bluff. No, Shalom, first of all. I wouldn't call their bluff out at all. No bad behavior can be fixed with pure positive. It's impossible. Pure positive training is made to reward and enhance a wanted behavior. And if any trainer knows how to read, if they know how to read, they can read what positive reinforcement means. It's there to reward a wanted behavior positively. Food, verbal praise, physical touch, toy, you know, anything. It won't get rid of any bad behavior. It's not possible. It's actually impossible. It can't be done. So the only way to eliminate a bad behavior is through punishment. When people talk about science, that's what the science says. But I'm not here to talk about science, and I don't want you to talk about science at all. What I want you to do is ignore it, stay in your lane, keep doing what you're doing. I love to get to Israel. Put a seminar. Put a seminar together for me. For the Israeli seminar, if I recouped my travel expense, I fly first class, so my travel expense and my housing, and even if I didn't make a lot of money on the seminar, I'd come to Israel. Absolutely, I'd come to Israel. Next.
What brand of raised beds do y'all use?
Cheryl, those are from Petcot.com, but you can use anything, but give Petcot a call. Tell them I sent you. I don't make any money on it, but tell them I sent you. That's another thing. People think I like make money on all this, like all my Periscopes and social media. The only thing I make money on in social media is I monetize some of my YouTube videos, but we're talking about, you know, pennies. Like, this is all free, man. It's all free content. Next.
I got nothing right now.
Nothing at all. So if you're just tuning in, my name is Jeff Gellman of Solid Canine Training. I'm a balanced dog trainer, which means I believe in yes and no, which means we reward and we punish. And you go to my website at Solid Canine Training. Check me out. Make sure you check out my Instagram stories. And on Instagram, on YouTube, Pinterest. So, oh boy, the swimming photos. Those swimming photos we've been putting out. Ah, damn, those are good. Those are really, really good. Next.
What's your opinion on a double dog kennel that allows the use of a partition or kennel together?
Trish, no opinion. None whatsoever. If you like it, use it. So double door. So, oh, I see. So side by each or side by side with a partition, and you can either have it be one kennel or two kennels. Works for me. But with your two dogs, I don't want them kenneled in the same kennel. Kennel them separate. Next.
I have two dogs. Wondering if I should use e-collar 320 for two dogs. Confusing or just one at a time?
It's actually Peggy. It's the 302. I would use the 302 just so you have one handset. Next. But you can turn the 300 into a two-dog unit. Next.
Both of our dogs recoil in fear at the sound of clicker. Can this be overcome?
Yes, it can. I would muffle the clicker by putting the clicker in your pocket and doing lots of food. Lots of food. Click food, click food, click. So don't ask them to do anything. Click food, click food, click food, click food, click food, click food, click food. Just do that. They'll love the clicker. Next.
Trish said why?
Why? So because I don't want them to have separation anxiety. That's why. I want them to be able to work on their own without having to depend on each other. That's personal choice. That's personal choice. But if you want to, do it. Next.
Would an example of layering be to teach with leash, treats, etc., then mix, add, remote?
Exactly. Yeah, layering is going to be exactly that. We train on a leash, and then we add the remote over it. So you're asking the dog to do a command that it's already working on, and you're adding in just the...
That's after they learn the...
But they don't have to know it though. But they don't have to know it fully. You can actually start using a remote right from the beginning. Many dog trainers train go right to remote. There's plenty of my colleagues. They go right to the remote collar. We usually do 2 to 3 days of prong leash, and then we layer the remote on top of it. Next.
Heather says, Trish, my three all crate in separate crates in same room works great.
All right, excellent.
We all have our ways.
Yep, whatever works for you, Trish.
The mini or the boss? I have an 85-pound Amstaff who has major anxiety around new dogs, very reactive.
Ashley, you know, the thing about this is the mini educator, put it this way. Okay. If you're even thinking about getting the boss, and if you have the budget for the boss, get the boss, and I'll tell you why. You can be gentle with the boss, but you're going to run out of power on the mini. But most dogs don't need more than the mini.
And I have a hard time seeing his working level.
So, Ashley, his working level is this. I want to make sure that the remote collar is on super snug, so your dog doesn't have a lot of fur, so make sure that the regular contact point should work fine. Super snug, here or here. With that breed of dog, you should start seeing the muscles. Like, so watch. I can't do it. You should see the muscles twitch. The muscles should twitch. Okay, so even if a lot of your bully breeds, the face, they don't make any recognition. So they won't make any recognition, but you can see their muscles twitch. All right. Oh, so 15 to 17, they twitch. So go a little bit lower. So I bet you your dog is feeling it at around a 12. So what you're going to do is this. Start working the dog, and then all of a sudden your levels are going to go down. That's what's going to happen. All right, your dog's going to get more tuned into you. And all of a sudden, the levels go down. But you got it. You're there. You got it. 15 is not out of the norm. All right.
Thank you for answer regarding clicker.
Oh, you're welcome. Yeah. And they make some clickers that are softer, too. They make some clickers that are softer.
So would you not let puppy and adult dog interact at all, even introduce and then exist?
Oh, I would absolutely let them interact. This is the thing. I don't know anything about your dog. Your other dog could be the biggest bully a-hole in the world. You know, I know nothing about your other dog. So it's a couple of things. What's the behavior of your other dog? What's your skill as far as introducing dogs? Are you going to overreact? Are you going to underreact? There's a lot of variables. Does that make sense? So it's almost like baking a cake. So a little bit too much of this, not enough of that, you can mess it all up. And if you don't turn the freaking oven on, you got yourself a mess. So what I want you to do is, I would need to know more information. So absolutely introduce them, but just don't overwhelm the puppy with the other dog. And on the flip side of it, don't let the little puppy beat up on the older dog either. So it's a give and take. It's a give and take. Next.
If a dog approaches my dog reactive dog quickly and my dog barks and lunges on a prong, is that good?
No, it's terrible. If a dog approaches your dog, reactive dog, so you have a dog, reactive dog, and a dog approaches it, and your dog barks and lunges. No, I don't want your dog to be barking and lunging. I want your dog to ignore it, and I want you to get the other dog away. So what you do is, I want your dog to, I mean, obviously if the dog is attacking your dog, drop the leash. Give your dog a fighting chance as you're getting this other dog off your dog. But if it's just a dog that's rushing, which could lead to a fight, what I want you to do is your first step of defense is you put your dog behind you, you stand in front of your dog. I want you to push the dog away because you're trying to fix dog reactivity. So what happens is every time your dog reacts to a dog, your dog reactivity training goes out the door. So what I want you to do is get your dog to go behind you, you stand in front, you try to neutralize the threat. That's what I want you to do. Obviously, if this dog doesn't leave you alone, F it. Drop the freaking leash. You know, I don't want my dogs fighting, but I'm also not going to, like, try to fend off a dog for, you know, more than 15 seconds, in my opinion. Next.
I have the boss and love it. Very low working level and precise.
Awesome.
I'm even more thankful for all of your videos, periscopes, etc. when I see other training videos for sale.
Awesome. Videos. Yep.
Do you have any advice on how to introduce a dog to an infant for the first time? Our dog has shown anxiety and growling around babies.
Okay.
In the past.
So this is you should be doing a periscope with me. By the way, I do free
Skype.
A Skype with me. I'm sorry. You can do a Skype with me. So I've got to actually on my Facebook page on a desktop or laptop. You can see all the tabs. I got more tabs than an 80 soda machine. There's one that says free Skype. Click on that. And then there's a sign up form. It's an automated process. It just shows up in my calendar whenever I've got free Skypes. And I do a couple of those a day. What I want you to do is this with a baby. The introduction is this. You ready? I've got a baby in my arms right now, okay? And this is where my dogs are. That's the introduction. That's the introduction. So if you, oh, let me see, is this YouTube? Okay. On YouTube, what I'm doing on YouTube is all my questions, this is my YouTube camera. Everybody on YouTube, I'm madly in love with you. I'm answering all my questions on Periscope. What I'm going to do is I'm going to get back to you tomorrow with some, I'm going to answer your questions on YouTube specifically tomorrow. But if you want to jump on Periscope, I can get to your questions over there tonight. Okay. I love all my fans on YouTube. Thank you so much for watching. For the baby, don't be in a rush. I want it to do existence. I want your dog, first of all, to be trained in duration, place command, or duration down. I don't want your dog to go into any bedroom anymore. I want that if you've got a two-floor house and the bedrooms are on the second floor, I want the dog on the first floor. I want to make sure you crate your dog at night, crate your dog when you're not home, and I want your dog to learn how to exist around the baby. I also don't want you to leave that baby unattended, not even for one split second. There's a lot of other variables, but that's a good start. Next.
My 16-pound mutt physically jerks at collar, 25 level, but keeps reacting. Tough nut.
So Peggy, so this is the thing: is the remote collar is, first of all, you put a prong collar on your dog so you can have some clutching gas on the jerking part. That'll stop the jerking. Remember, remote collars are not directional. I want to make sure you're using a prong collar, remote collar combo. Prong collar all the way up, remote collar underneath that. Teach the dog how to heel properly on the prong, layer the remote collar on over that. But remember, the remote collar is not directional. Tapping the remote collar does not give that dog any information to heel next to you. You still have to teach the actual heel. That's why we like the prong collar on there as well. Next.
Bought longer prongs, not seeing dog's working level until 28. Collar not tight enough?
Donna, the collar is probably not tight enough, yes.
Another question, what is your opinion regarding the comfort pads? My dog has a lot of neck roll.
So the comfort pads work on a lot of dogs with no fur, but the neck roll thing might not quite work. So also when you're using comfort pads, your levels usually have to increase a little bit. Who's good for a comfort pad? A lot of boxers and a lot of pitties are usually pretty good because there's no fur whatsoever and they don't have a lot of rolls. So with you, you might need the actual, you know, the contacts instead of the comfort pads. Next.
What's the difference between mace and bear spray?
Bear spray projects way farther. So mace is used for, well, it depends. If you get police department mace, it's made for projectile. It looks like a small fire extinguisher. It's made to project really, really far. The mace that you find like on a keychain is for used for close quarters. And the spray pattern sprays out much farther immediately. Where bear spray, the spray pattern will project first before it sprays out. As far as the amount of capsium in it, or I'm not even sure what they use in bear spray, which one is more powerful. I just like bear spray because it projects farther. I don't want the dog to be that close to me if I'm going to be utilizing it. Next.
True. She's high energy border collie, but will recall and listen to me if she gets too pushy. Planning on slight interaction and mostly keep her focused on me and then long place inside.
Sounds like a great idea.
I have bear spray and it's very potent, dangerous, and shoots out fast in a fog up to 15 feet.
There you go. That's what I like. That's what I like. That's good for oncoming dogs. Yep.
She'll place and chill out for hours in the house with distractions.
Oh, good. All right. If you're talking about, that's the one with the puppy, right?
I don't know.
Yeah, I think that's the one with the puppy. So that's good. All right. So good. It looks like you got yourself. Looks like you got yourself covered. I think, you know, you're going to do well. Just remember, just make sure that it's not too one-sided. But when you have an eight-week-old puppy, you're shaping these dogs for the rest of their lives. You know what I mean? You're shaping these dogs for the rest of their lives. So let's make sure we've got some good even play. And I wouldn't be surprised if that little puppy chases around your border collie a lot, tires itself out, and just probably falls asleep, you know, in the middle of the grass somewhere. Next.
Should muzzle be used if GSD redirected once on husband while on prom? Small yappy dog ran up on walk.
Cheryl, that's personal choice. Or your husband just has to be super, super quick. Or just super quick. So, but that's, you know, that's going to be, you know, personal choice for you, you know, if you want to do that or not. What I would do is I would just proof that a little bit more if you can. But if your husband feels safer, absolutely, absolutely.
What size contacts do you recommend for the e-collar tech? I have a Labrador who has longer hair.
The cool thing is, Alex, is those come with the short ones and the longer ones. The only ones they don't, the only ones that they don't have is the thick fur ones, which you probably don't need, but they do make a thick fur contact point. Next.
So sorry, lost internet connection and only got the tail end of that answer. Ha ha, it's a GSD pup, by the way.
I'm not sure what you're talking about.
That 8-week puppy, we just answered like 3 questions about it.
I don't know.
Hi guys, I'm late. Maybe you answered already, but how do you stop dog reactivity? Oh, hey Steph, how's it going?
Hey Steph, how are you?
Always wants to go to other dogs.
So what I want you to do, Steph, is remember we've talked about this many, many times. So it's what you're going to do is, you know, prong collar on your dog, and I want you to always make sure that you're giving information to that dog at the first sign. At the first sign of nonsense out. Getting any nonsense out. So as soon as that dog starts getting like aroused, squash the arousal. Squash the arousal like a cold shower. That's what I want you to do. That's the best way to do it. Instead of reacting to it, be proactive to it. All right, next.
How would you replace praise and the rewards with toys?
Bo, to me, it's hard to train. The only thing I would use, you know, the only thing I would use a toy with is if I'm doing some like long duration stuff or maybe some trick training or something like that. Basic obedience, though, I don't use toys. I'm a family dog trainer. I know in a lot of sports they do a lot, but we'll use a tug sometimes. It's so much easier to just use food or verbal praise or physical touch. Next.
So few trolls on a Monday, maybe you condition them out.
Eric, you know, I mean, I've probably banned, I don't know, I've banned, well, actually, I know how many I've banned. I banned 2,200 people. There's a list of all my banned people, all my trolls. Also, Twitter, which Periscope is owned by, is doing a little bit better on their algorithms to weed trolls out organically. But to me, they can do a better job. It's pretty simple to get rid of trolls. Anybody that's been banned from 50 or more different Periscope feeds is obviously a troll. So why don't they get rid of them? Sort of obvious. So it's sort of obvious. If you're getting banned by all these people, obviously you're an asshole. So you don't belong on Periscope. But it is what it is. Next.
Steph said, got it. Think I'm reacting too
late. Yeah, Steph, a lot of people do. A lot of people wait. Stop waiting. Stop waiting. Next.
Do you offer website design?
Alex, I do. I've got a separate company. It's called Jeff Gellman Media. Jeff Gellman Media. So if you go to www.jeffgellmanmedia.com, you can learn all about, I do website design. But actually the big thing is our social media program, our SEO stuff, our Facebook ads, our Google ads. We can help you with event planning, things like that. But yes, we also do website design. And if you're looking to do your own website, Squarespace is a really great platform to do your own website. It's very user-friendly. There's some really, really good templates. Next.
Should type of treat change for more challenging tasks?
Not necessarily. I mean, you could use high value rewards if you want to. We use dog food. We use the dog's daily food. You know, it's up to you. Next.
Just signed up because of your great site.
Oh, thanks, Luce.
Three-year-old Malamute GSD seems to be getting more defensive with age towards I'm losing these towards other females. Any tips?
Stuart, yeah, punish it. You know, this is it. So the three-year-old, if it's what I would do is this, is whenever a dog, well, first of all, 3 years old, I mean, I doubt its health. Sometimes when we see a sudden change in dog's behavior, it could be a thyroid issue, but that's very, very, very rare. But if you've been seeing a lot of bad behavior from your dog, pushiness, snidiness, a little bit of resource guarding of anything, now all of a sudden you're starting to get reactivity, it's most likely just an escalation of bad behaviors that have now finally just exploded. So what I would do is I would just punish the dog for being reactive. Just like any other reactivity, what you want to do is you want to make sure you get it before the dog gets reactive. And it's just, you know, teach the dog the concept of no. You can do that with a prong collar. You can do that with a remote collar. You can do that with a bonker. The bottom line is, how do you stop an unwanted behavior now? And that is through punishment. And that's the only way you can do it. Next.
I want to teach puppy to be okay with other animals and people. Would training her around them work?
It can either work for you or work against you, depending, again, Lisa, you know, on how knowledgeable you are. So what I would be doing is, yes, have your dog in a controlled environment with people and dogs. But once your dogs are socialized, I say then just have them around them. So you can have interaction through structured socialization. But once your dog is comfortable with dogs and humans, then now we're done. Now I want to be everything to my dog. To the follow-up to the three-year-old Malamute, after a beagle bit the dog, absolutely. So that's why your dog now is more reactive. So what you've got to do is you've got to step it up, advocate for your dog. That happens all the time with dogs. They have a bad experience with dogs, and then they go on guard. The big thing is, I'm going to go after you before you go after me. So what you want to do is make sure you are advocating for your dog. The dog lost trust in you. It's not your fault, but the dog did lose trust in you. So now the best way to earn it back is to protect your dog. Next.
Thank you for all of your knowledge.
Oh, you're welcome.
Is it wrong to say no with different levels of intensity?
Both. Technically, it's not wrong. It's not necessary. Next.
If you do react with a correction too late, does that really undo any progress you've made?
Nothing that can't be repaired. I make mistakes. My staff makes mistakes. If a dog trainer says they never make mistakes, they're lying. So I think that if you happen to be late, note to self and do better next time. Got it? Don't beat yourself up. Next.
Thanks as always, guys. Love you both. Time to go train more. True pinnacle of value added content.
Awesome, Eric. The beagle. Here, we do that one.
How much would it cost for you to make a video on preventing bad behavior?
All my videos are on preventing bad behavior. Do you know what I mean? You can do a Skype. I mean, Lisa, if you've got a lot of questions, just do a Skype session. Book a Skype session with me. That's how I actually make a living. Like right before this, I did 2 paid Skype sessions right before this. So I had one at 6:45. I did 2 half-hour Skype sessions right before this. So, I mean, I'll just tell you, I mean, I charge for dog trainers, it's $300 an hour. For private people, it's $200 an hour. So for half an hour, it's $125. And guess what? It's literally the same thing as this. So this is how I make a living. So if you've got a lot of questions, I don't need to make a video. You can just get your own private Periscope. It won't be a Periscope. It'll be Skype. And you can ask me as many questions as you want to, and we can go over it. We can go over all this stuff. So you really don't need a video. I already have 5,000 videos out there. What you might need is just some one-on-one training to help, like, get you going in the right place. But what I want you to do is train everything you want and punish everything you don't want. You know? Got it? Next.
No more. Yep. My small dog is working on level 1. Sometimes she has a reaction, jumps. Should I get stim reducer?
Vonda, get a stim reducer. Yeah, and if people don't know what a stim reducer is, a stim reducer is, it reduces the stim of the remote collar. When you've got some super sensitive dogs that are like on a level 1 or 2, you really don't have a lot of flexibility. So they make something called a stim reducer. So what happens is if you put it on, now you're maybe at like a 3, 4, 5, I would get a stim reducer. Absolutely. Absolutely.
Skype sessions are super worth it.
Yep. Awesome.
Thanks, Raquel.
Go ahead, read it.
Does hitting with bonker have a different meaning association than hit with hand? I don't hit with hand, but occasionally poke if not on leash.
Absolutely, yeah. I mean, striking a dog with your hand is a big difference than a bonker. A bonker is a rolled up towel. You say no, and then you throw the towel at them. It's got a way different meaning than using your physical hand. It's a projectile. Dogs hate projectiles. You can also project it. I mean, how good your aim? I mean, you can project it 20 feet away. Dogs rushing towards the door, say no, whiz the bonker. You can do that. Dogs just hate projectiles. Plus, what you're doing is you're teaching the dog the word no. First, hitting the dog with a hand, you know, I think a lot of people, first of all, that's not how we train. That's not how you should train. But I think there's this concept out there saying, you know, I've never hit my dog with my hand. You know what? I have. You know, and I think most owners have. I mean, when we're talking about hitting a dog with your hand, we're not talking about running up to your dog and punching them and punching them and punching them. That's not what we're talking about. We're not talking about an angry action. But if I'm sitting down, say, and I'm eating a sandwich, and all of a sudden one of my dogs comes up and goes, hey, is that peanut butter and jelly? And I'll be like, get away from me, dog. Like, this concept of, like, using your hand to push a dog away or to bop a dog on a nose. I mean, I think we've gone into a world now where people are like, oh, my gosh, you just hit your dog. Really? Like, that on my dog's nose? Like, stop that? Like, if people are assimilating that with abuse, number one, you don't know what abuse is at all. Number two, you know, you really might want to rethink your concept of, like, training. Now, if the dog doesn't sit, do I go like that? No. The dog doesn't, no, I don't. But if I'm like, my dog's not any equipment on, and I'm sitting there and my dog's getting in my space, of course you use your hand to get away. Like, get away from me. Like, what's the big deal? I think we've gotten into a society now where any physical touch of our dog is bad. It's like, No, it's not. And then 3 seconds later, I can use that hand to pet my dog. My dogs are not afraid of my hand. There's a big difference between that and literally like striking your dog out of anger. Do you know what I mean? It's a huge difference. And I think that it's sort of sad that we've really, gotten into that space where these dogs are these fragile things. Like if you work dogs, like I work dogs and I work my dogs hard. Like I work my dogs real hard. Okay. The other day, Kira bounced off of girl and bounced into a tree. And if I did that, I'd probably be knocked unconscious. Like if that was me that got bounced off, I probably would have broken something or been knocked unconscious. What did girl do? She limped for a tiny bit. And then she was like back at it. Do you know what I mean? I mean, dogs are very hardy creatures. They really, really are. And this concept that they're these little fragile China things, it's like, give me a break. Come on, guys. Let's go. What's next?
Enjoyed your outside video today. Linda, love your hair.
Oh, Donna, thank you. And if you don't know what she's, Donna's returning, referencing, I did a video sort of, my buddy Sean O'Shea, he loves it, by the way. If you want to go into Sean O'Shea's videos and talk shit about him, it makes him laugh just for the attention. He'll delete you and ban you and send you to the cornfields. The cornfields. But this is the thing. People are like, there's this highly aggressive dog that he's working with, and it was like, it might have to be an outside dog. And everybody's like freaking out, like, oh my God, it's going to be banished to outside. And when you hear about an outside dog, people are like, what? It's going to be tied to a 6-foot chain and like, tied to a tree. And so I did a little video showed all my dogs all outside, and I'm like, which dog lives outside? Some of you know my dog, so you got it right, but most people couldn't tell which dog lives outside. Like an outside dog, put it this way, if I had land, if I had property, I would have almost all my dogs literally living outside. They would have access probably to a barn or some climate control building, but my dogs would live outside. Why? Because dogs love living outside. That's why. They would love it. They would love it year round, even in the wintertime. Sure, they have a warm place to go to, but you give a dog an option inside of a house or outside, they're going to pick outside every single time. So that's the video that she was referring to. And you can go back to that on Periscope. Next. And I gave a little tour of my personal property and where my dogs live and the lifestyle that I have. Next.
My dog shoves his nose harder than a quick pop of a paw.
Exactly.
I have land and barn dogs love it. Live inside and out their choice.
Donna, perfect lifestyle. Perfect. Yep. Next.
My childhood Weimaraner probably spent 12 nights and 15 years in the house. Hated being inside. Ohio.
Yep, exactly. Yep, I'm from Ohio too. So yeah, I mean, most dogs live, I drive my RV across the country. I put around probably about 20 to 25,000 miles, on my RV every year. And I see this beautiful country that we live in. And guess what? A lot of dogs live outside. A lot of dogs live outside.
We had one dog, Roka, Akita, and he loved to lay in a snowbank.
Yep.
And he loved to lay in the snow and have it snow on him.
Yep.
He loved it.
We had a long-haired Akita that lived outside. It'd be snowing here, freezing cold and snowing. And all of a sudden you'd go outside and you'd be like, Roka, Roka. And all of a sudden he would pop up.
Yeah. You think he was sleeping?
Yep.
Because he'd be so still under that snow.
Yep. He'd just pop up with all the snow lying on top of him. He loved it. And guess what? He had a place to go to that was warm inside. He chose outside. Dogs are really smart.
They know when to go inside.
Right. Exactly.
We're all missing a ton of the natural world. So are our dogs.
No, exactly.
It's true, Heather.
It's true.
Like those sled dogs. Yeah, like a sled dog.
Exactly.
They love it.
Trust me. Most dogs love living outside.
My dogs don't like living outside.
No, they don't. But you have chihuahuas. It's different. I think people have to understand. It's a little bit different. Next.
That's it. That's all I have.
Really awesome. So let's see what we got here for YouTube.
Do your prong collars ever come undone? I use a Herm Springer, have to use double leash because it comes undone.
Yeah, I mean if it's coming undone, if your leash is if it's coming in, it's probably, it could be a cheap remote prong collar, it could be human error, or the prongs have been stretched out too far. All right, so take a look at those. Take a look at those. Just got Sean's book. Awesome. Yeah, read Sean's book. It's wonderful. Can you go grab it over there? The good dog way.
Yeah.
Sean's book is fantastic. I sat down. I read it. I think in two little sessions there. It's a fun. It's a great book. No matter how you train dogs, you know, anybody should get it. But it's this right here. You go to thegooddogway.com. Thegooddogway.com. And it's called Love Them by Leading Them. And it's a fantastic book. It's a really, really good book. He's done, I don't even know how much it is. I think they're $30. I bought 10 of them. I bought them for all my staff. So he signed them for all my staff. Let's see.
Headed to Shadow with him next week. Nice.
Oh, awesome, Elizabeth. You'll have a great time. You'll have a really, really great time. He's a good guy to Shadow.
What does the term foundational mean in regard to training drills?
I think foundational is just basic commands. Just basic commands. Someone writes on YouTube, can you make a video of clicker training not working?
No.
Pinnacle of gauge? No. I mean clicker, the biggest thing with clicker training not working is bad timing. Probably bad timing. That would be the big thing with clicker training, is just the timing is wrong. Or the dog doesn't understand where the clicker is. A lot of times people, I can easily make it. I mean, you don't need me to make a video on that. It's just don't teach a dog what a clicker is. And then the clicker has no use. Clicker is a tool that has no value until you teach the dog what the clicker is. So, and I don't do video requests anyway. Hi from Australia. Love all your advice. You're a little piece of sanity in a whole sea of, those are all, I guess it's saying shit. Thank you. You have no sound. I would turn up your volume. Maybe. Do you have any advice on how to introduce a dog to an infant for the first time? I already answered that. Yeah, but these are important too. These are my YouTubers.
Okay.
My dog doesn't come when I call sometimes and doesn't give me any eye contact. What can I do to fix that? So Muffet, what you want to do is teach the dog recall. So recall is a command. The dog just wasn't come automatically. What I would do is I would get that dog to start on a 6 foot or a 10 or 15 foot leash, train the dog actual recall. We do that with a combination of verbal leash pressure and food. Teach it what it means. We layer the remote collar over that. But don't let your off-leash dog don't let your dog off leash unless it knows the word come. Jeff Lobot from Miami. I have a serious problem with my dog. Jet skis, motorcycles, what can I do? I'm not quite sure what the problem is. If your dog is super sensitive to that, what you can do is you can actually correct the bad behavior. So say your dog's in a down or in place and it hears a jet ski and it freaks out, you can actually correct the act of freaking out. But what I would do is I would not, that's how you start it. If your dog's going after jet skis, you can punish that by making it uncomfortable. All right. What do you feed your German Shepherds? Depending on which ones they are, I either do from chicken, or two of my dogs are on the raw diet, and that's from Volhard Nutrition. Please come to Minnesota. Holly, I won't be going to Minnesota anytime soon. I'm sorry, I cannot be everywhere at all. Let's see. Your German Shepherd sometimes gets all ramped up on a walk if you meet another dog. Well, we've talked about that in many of my videos. So in many of my videos, we've got that. So what I want you to do is, what you would do is you would punish it before it gets ramped up. We've gone over that many, many times about punishing. So as soon as that dog gets ramped up, punish it right before it. Okay, go back. What's the raw diet? Raw diet, just go on to, literally go on to Google, type in raw diet recipes. And there's so many websites out there. There's so many Facebook groups out there.
Maybe stretched out. I bought the smallest prom size.
It could be stretched out. It could be just a cheap one that the prongs are not real strong.
She said before it's a Hermsbrenner. Mm.
Let me just keep doing it like this to get through these YouTube ones.
I did have a small one come apart on me once, yep. Remember?
What's your best advice for a puppy constantly dominating your extremely submissive older dog? Jody, it's up to you to punish the dog. So it's up to you to do it. So what you're going to do is, if you're you have to advocate for your older dog. So what I would do is I would get a bonker. A bonker is a towel. You wrap up the towel. You would say no, and you would toss the bonker at the other dog. The problem is I don't want it to hit your calmer dog or more submissive dog. All right? So Linda's got to get going. Thank you, Linda, so much. You're a huge asset to the show. I'm going to just go through all these,
later.
Great. And then Holly just says, you know, you are awesome. Thank you so much. Thank you, everybody on YouTube. I try to get all to your questions. I think I answered all the YouTube questions. I think I did. I do Volhard Nutrition. Volhard Nutrition, and you can get a hold of Ann Green. Ann Green is my my rep. Just go to look up Ann Green on Facebook underneath Green Dogs. That's with an E at the end. So G-R-E-E-N-E. Also, if you go to Volhard Nutrition, Volhard, just Google it. I think it's V-O-L-H-A-R-D. It might be an H-L, Volhard Nutrition. You can just find it online. And then what you do is when you go to that, you can, I get the lazy man's version. I think it's called the NFD2 or something. And I buy it in 20-pound bags. It's a dry powder. I add water and then I add raw beef. I add 80-20 beef. Let's see, Australia. What was that? There we go. So that was that. There we go. I think I got them all. All right, everybody. I just want to let you all know that it's Jeff Gellman of Solid Canine Training. Thanks. I'll be on tomorrow doing lots more stuff. I appreciate everybody. Appreciate all your kindness, all your awesome questions. And thank you so much. Take care. Bye-bye.